does her best to hide the pain that she's been through. When she cries at night, and she doesn't think that I can hear her, she tries to hide all the fear she feels inside. So I Well, I'm very excited today to have a special guest on with me that I just got to know about a year and a half ago. But I've known him and I've known his music for many, many years. In fact, when I used to travel with the band Mid-South back in the mid-80s, we found a cassette called Wheels by Restless Heart. And that's all we played in the bus over and over and over. And here is the original drummer, vocalist, for Restless Heart, retired now. This is John Dittrich. John, I'm glad to have you on my show.
Well, hello, Bobby, and good to see you again. And hello, everybody.
Yeah, it's good to see you too. I got to know you about a year and a half ago. A mutual friend of ours, Chris Goff, told me that he was having what they called a lunch club about once a month. And you were involved in it and a couple of other guys in Nashville, and he invited me, and I was so excited to get to meet you, and we just kind of hit it off, didn't we?
We did, and our how Lunch Club started was a very dear friend of mine, and I'm sure all of ours, Dick McVeigh,
yeah,
who had an incredible career in the music business, coming up from the coal fields coal mines of West Virginia. When he was just a kid, he held just about every job there was to hold in the music business, and became quite a well-known and beloved figure. In Nashville, he actually started the Lunch Club.
Oh, he did.
He did. He called me and suggested that, you know, we get to get together for lunch once a month, and it was just the two of us there for a little while, and then I suggested that he should meet Chris Goff because he and Chris might be able to do some things together, and that's basically how Lunch Club started. And Chris brought you in,
yeah,
and you brought Greg in,
yep.
And I don't know where it stands right now, other than just the three of you guys.
It's the three of us, and then, you know, I have invited a couple of people, but they couldn't make it. Chris had invited a couple; they couldn't make it. But we had last month we met, and we had one guy show up. Used to travel with the gospel group, the Hensons. Eric Henson showed up, so it was interesting to get. I hadn't seen him in years. So it's interesting to get to see him again and talk about the good old days.
But, did Chris Goff get the ceremonial samurai sword?
He did. It took a little while for me to get it to him, but I finally got it to him, and he's got it. So
I bet he's out there chopping weeds with it.
I'm sure he is. So as far as meeting Chris, how did that come about? I heard that y'all were playing some game on Facebook or something.
Well, yeah, you know, that was very interesting. Somehow or other, we ended up playing this. We ended up playing this golf game online. We didn't know each other, and we were involved. Every now and then, we'd play each other in this golf game online, and he never knew who I was. I never knew who he was. And somehow or other, we hooked up after that. We met. Then I invited him to Lunch Club with Dick.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think Chris still knew who I was.
Yeah.
at that first lunch that we had.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, he was listening to the radio or something, and heard When She Cries.
Mm-hmm.
And somehow or other, my name, you know, got associated with it.
Yeah.
And Chris told me, he went, "Holy mackerel.
That's him."
I've been playing golf with this guy online for a year and a half, went to lunch with him and didn't know who he was. So
that's
my
crazy.
One of my favorite songs, one of my favorite groups, is I couldn't believe I didn't know who he was, you know. That just never got brought up.
Well, to be honest with you, if I would have seen you out in public somewhere, I probably wouldn't have recognized you. Because I remember the younger John Dietrich. You know, I haven't seen you since you got, like me, got the gray going on, you know.
Well, and also, you know, the fact, and you know, Larry Stewart and I discussed this on several occasions. Bands are hard. When you have a solo artist, it's much easier to be recognizable. But when you're in a band, you're kind of incognito when you're in a band, unless you're the lead singer and you get a lot of camera time. And, you know, of course, Larry was known, you know, but the rest of us weren't.
Right.
Okay,
he was more the front man, you know, out in the front doing all the lead singing until he left the band. And then you became more of the lead singer.
Yeah, I became the lead singer the first time that he left. And we didn't have a record deal for like the first 18. Well, we had a record deal, but we didn't get a record out for the first 18 months that he was gone. And I gotta have to tell you, it got a little brutal out there on the road, because we didn't have a record out without him, with me as the lead singer. And it you know, I remember people getting up and walking out of shows, and it was pretty discouraging.
Yeah.
And of course, then we were very fortunate. We had the big hit record.
Yeah.
When She Cries, and that put us back on the map. It was short lived because When She Cries was a big pop record.
Yeah.
And country radio had basically already written us off at that point. Mm-hmm. And the pop market being as fickle as it is, we had the huge hit. And then the next year we didn't have a pop record and we couldn't get booked.
You know, that sounds very familiar to me, because we kind of went through that same thing, you know, when Mid-South kind of went, like, we had a pop hit in 95 that crossed over in pop. Mm-hmm. And then after that, it was like, that was it. You know, you try to go back to country and it's like, nah, that's it.
Yeah. But, well, I remember, I don't know if you remember, years ago, on the big 98 of Love radio station, Jerry House.
Yep.
Who was an institution in Nashville.
He
was the guy that everybody in the industry listened to.
Right.
Every record label, every artist, every man, everybody listened to Jerry House. What mm-hmm. he said was gospel, you know. And I remember listening to Jerry House one morning shortly after Larry left, and they were talking about Larry leaving the band on the air. And, you know, Jerry said, you know, I heard that those guys were going to go on without Larry. And he said, those guys were setting off airport security, you know, all over the country. He said, because those boys got rocks in their head. You know, think they're going to go on without Larry. And I'm like, oh, man. You know,
thanks, Jerry.
Well, and, you know, and Jerry was a friend of mine.
Yeah, yeah.
We lived, as Jerry said, you know, he could probably tee up a three-wood and hit my house
mm-hmm.
from his house.
Yeah.
And, boy, that just was like a knife.
I bet.
So, at any rate, everything in 2001, this happened in 1990, at the end of 1991, I remember we had, We had just gotten back from Europe. We had just done two shows with Toto in Germany. And the day after we got home, I got a call from our manager saying that Larry Stewart wanted to have a meeting. And I said over the phone, I said, Larry's going to quit, isn't he?
Just had that feeling.
I don't know. Well, I don't know. I said, yes, you do, you lying sack. You know he's going to quit. Why are we having a meeting? Why don't you just tell us?
Yeah.
So we got together at the meeting. Sure enough, Larry had a meeting. Larry quit, mm-hmm. You know. And, you know, we were all like, well, you had to drag us all down here for that. You know, could have done it over the phone.
Yeah, but the good thing is the rest of you guys were great singers, too. It wasn't like y'all were no good, well, you know. You had great voices as well.
Well, we were, but the industry didn't know it.
True. They just heard Larry. Yeah.
They didn't know there were other lead singers in the band. Yeah. And I'll tell you, when the band first started out, it was always the plan to follow the Eagles blueprint and several other bands' blueprint of having more than one lead singer.
Yeah.
You know, well, our philosophy as a band was the best voice for the song. You know, Larry, you know, might not have been the best voice for some of the songs.
Yeah.
Any more than I would have been the best voice for some of the songs, you know, and we were, you know, we were all for, okay, let's record each one of the three lead singers singing the song and the best voice wins. Well, the label shut that down real fast.
And messes up your identity.
We had a number one single with Larry. We don't want to confuse radio.
Right.
You know, well, you know, nobody was confused about confusing radio, in the pop and the rock market.
No.
But apparently that was an issue with country.
Doesn't work in country, yeah.
We never got the chance to have anybody else sing one of the hits.
Yeah.
Until Larry left. And there's a very interesting story about When She Cries, that hit record that we had.
I know you told me, and I want you to tell the folks out there about that.
Briefly, we were recording the album Big Iron Horses that When She Cries eventually would be on. And Josh Leo, who was our producer, came to us and said, I think we're going to be able to get this song. I think it's going to come off Holt. He said, if it does, he said, guys, he said, I have ideas for this song. And he said, I think this song is going to be a huge hit record for us. So a couple days later, he informed us that the song came off Holt. We recorded the song. Josh had the arrangement. He had everything worked out on the song, the way we were going to record it. It was not like the Nashville demo that was done.
Yeah.
And the writers were Sonny LaMare from Exile and Mark Beeson.
Mm-hmm.
And we recorded the song. We had a big hit on it, thankfully, because it saved our career at that point.
Yep.
And, you know, it wasn't until years later that I heard the background story on that song. Larry Stewart had actually recorded that song first for his first solo album.
Wow.
Okay. And I don't know why we never knew that. Josh never told us where the song came from. And when they got to playing the song for the label and the management, they got to playing the whole album. Larry Fitzgerald, who was both of our managers at that time, having been Restless Heart's manager, he became Larry's manager and Restless Heart's manager. At the same time, which at that point I thought was a little bit of a conflict of interest.
Yeah.
You know, but they were hands down the best management company we felt, so we didn't, you know, it wasn't really a huge issue for us.
Mm-hmm.
But Larry Fitzgerald in that meeting said, you know, he said, there's only one song on this album that just doesn't seem to fit. And Larry said, Larry, what's that? And he said, When She Cries. And Larry Stewart said, you're kidding me. That's my favorite song.
Oh, man.
And he said, Larry, it just doesn't seem to fit. Now, I don't know, as years have gone by, I don't know if it was in the back of Larry Fitzgerald's mind to say, you know, Larry, you don't need this one. The guys really do. So I want the song off this album so the guys can have it. And I have no idea if that has any basis in fact. It was just a passing thought of mine years later. But at any rate, yeah, the rest is history. And I told Larry, we were doing an interview and Larry told that story. And I mean, this was years later. And I'm like, how come I'm just now hearing this story about this song?
Man, can you imagine said, if, can you imagine said, if they left that, knew. If you had left that on Larry's album?
Well,
that would have changed everything. I mean,
I don't know. I really don't know.
You really don't know.
And I've never heard Larry's version.
Yeah, I was going to ask you if you'd heard it.
I've never heard Larry's version of it. But I will say that if he just pretty much copped the Nashville demo, it wouldn't have been the hit that it would have been, I don't believe, because yeah. we made it a very different song.
Yeah.
And I think that Josh Leo really brought the big hit factor to it.
Yeah.
So who knows? Nobody knows.
I remember, I forgot where we were, but we saw the video come out on CMT and it was like, man, this sounds better than anything else they've ever done. To me, it did. It sounded
and
more.
I think it was the edgiest record. I think that edgiest single. I think we put out
for sure. Yeah.
Sonically, Josh had these great ideas. You know, right away he just said, "I want the intro." He said, "You remember the song 'I'm Not in Love' by 10cc?"
Yep. Yep.
The way they started that on the synthesizer, yeah. He said, I want to do it with voices. He said, I want to do that with synthesizers. He said, John, I want you playing four on the floor on the bass drum, you know, two and four on the snare, just driving. And he said, yeah. Greg, I want that last worthless evening acoustic guitar.
Yeah.
You know, Don Henley acoustic guitar thing. And he put that whole thing together. That was brilliant on Josh's part.
It was just
brilliant. So that's how that song came about. And that's how Restless Heart's career was saved in 1993.
Yeah, so, I remember right after Larry had left the band, I saw y'all at Opryland.
Yeah.
And I didn't know he was gone. I saw y'all came out and I was like, where's Larry? You know, I mean, y'all still sound great, but I could tell. Well, y'all weren't quite gelling together yet because it just happened, you know. So
there were a lot of people thinking the same thing. I remember we decided to hide out in Canada and do a tour of Canada, to kind of tighten things up, and it didn't go well.
Really?
No, it didn't go well. I think about half the crowds, well, the Canadians, I'm not sure, knew that Larry had left.
Yeah.
And about half the crowds that we drew, originally they were close to sellouts in, you know, theaters.
Yeah.
And by the end of the show, more than half of them were gone.
That's crazy.
I never did hear anybody yell out from the audience, where's Larry? We decided to try to avoid that by stating right up front, you may notice that Larry Stewart is not here. Larry has decided to pursue a solo career, and we wish him all the best. And that's all we said.
Yeah.
You know, a friend of ours, Stu Cook from Creedence Clearwater Revival and the band Southern Pacific. He came to see us in California, and he came backstage afterwards and he said he was sitting right in the front row too. And he said, you know, he said, I thought about standing up in the middle of your show and going, "It's just not the same without Larry," and walk out. He said, but he said, then I got to thinking, you guys probably wouldn't think that was funny.
No,
you know, and I said, "You're right, Stu. We wouldn't have thought it was funny."
Yeah, no, not at that point, no. Now, I guess Big Iron Horses hadn't come out yet at that point.
It had not.
Yeah.
We were finished. We were basically finished with the album before we got this song. And once we got this song, a song had to be taken off the album because RCA, they didn't want to pay publishing on anything more than, once you put 10 songs on a record, somehow or other publishing changed. I don't know how that worked, but they didn't want more than 9 songs on an album.
Yeah.
So we had to knock one off to stay under 10. And so we took one of the records off. But
do you remember what song that was?
It was a song that Dave Innes wrote called "As Far as I Can Tell."
Well, that was on there. Yeah.
Well, it was on it. Oh, wait a minute. Maybe that wasn't the one we took off. "We're Gonna Be Okay." Was another song written by Dave that was taken off the record.
Okay.
So the album was ready to go. Then we got the song and we went back in and recorded this and we substituted the songs.
Okay.
So that's what happened there.
So you had success in pop radio. Then you put out another single to pop radio. Tell Me What You Dream.
Tell Me What You Dream. Yes. Actually, that song was written by Josh Leo, Timothy B. Schmidt from the Eagles, and a songwriter named Vince Melamed. And Vince was a touring keyboard player with the Eagles on the Long Run tour, as well as some earlier tours. And he and Tim got together and brought Josh in because Josh was touring with Glenn Frey when Glenn wasn't with the Eagles. And the three of them sat down and wrote this song. And fast forward to when we got the song, said Josh Leo was looking for songs for the album. And he put the word out to New York, the New York division of RCA, A&R. I need songs, for the album here. And he said, I get this call from this A&R guy who didn't know me from Adam in New York. And he said, I found this song. And he said, it was on Tim Schmidt's first solo album. He said it was never a single, but he said, I think it's a hit. And Josh is going, you're kidding me. And he said, what's the name of the song? And he said, it's a song called Tell Me What You Dream. Josh said, you gotta be kidding me. He said, I wrote that song with Tim. And he said, unbelievable how things happen.
Yeah.
You know, guy didn't know the history of the song, didn't know me from Adam, didn't know I was a writer, and now he's pitching me this song from New York. And he said, it's gotta be a sign.
Yeah.
It's gotta be a sign.
Yeah.
So we put the song out. It ended up being the number 2 adult contemporary record of the year.
Yeah.
It went number 1 AC. It was only released to the adult contemporary market. It wasn't released anywhere else. So,
Cool.
Interesting stories behind some of
so
these.
So after the success of When She Cries and Tell Me What You Dream on the pop side, did y'all ever discuss maybe we should go that direction instead of country?
Well, Joe Galante, who was the head of RCA New York at that time, came to us and said, guys, he said, I'm going to take you pop. He said, I'm going to break you worldwide. He said, your country career is over.
Yeah.
He said, that door is closed. He said, you've got the pop door wide open.
Yeah.
And he said, we're going to walk right through it. He said, I'm going to break this band worldwide. And then our manager got a call from the then head of RCA in Nashville, who told Larry, he said, the band's success was solely in country, except for this anomaly here. He said, the pop market is going to be done with you the minute you don't have another big hit.
Yep.
He said, the band will be over with. He said, we can resurrect the band's career at country, but the band has to disavow any relationship with pop radio. And they have to do it right now. They can't put out another record to pop. Well, Larry had a meeting with us and he scared us. He just scared us.
Yeah.
And so we went on record as saying, look, we're not a pop band. We're not going pop. And of course, you know, it shouldn't have come as any surprise when we were almost immediately dropped from the label. You know, there's an old saying in Nashville, you don't piss off Joe Galante.
Yeah.
And we pissed off Joe, who remains a good friend to this day, by the way, but business is business, yeah, you know.
Sure.
And we pissed him off and he went, okay, you guys don't want a career. See you later.
You're done. Yeah. You know,
nothing personal. I can't do anything with you. So I'm not going to waste any resources. So that was basically it.
You told me the story, and it's a similar story to us when we were with Warner. When they dropped us, we couldn't even get back in the building. I think you told me the same thing happened to you.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I used to be able to walk in the door,
yeah,
walk upstairs,
yep,
walk into anybody's office,
yep,
including Joe,
uh-huh,
as long as his door was open, you know, you could walk in. And I went down to RCA to, I needed to get something. I needed to get some copies of some CDs or something. Mm-hmm. And I stopped at the front desk and, you know, everybody I asked for wasn't in the building. They weren't there. Nobody was there. Nobody could let you upstairs. Sorry, you know, and that was it. And I remember sitting, there was a little park across the street from the RCA building when RCA at that location in those days.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember sitting with Beeb Birtles, who I was starting a band with, and Beeb was with the Little River Band, one of the original guys with the Little River Band. And I remember sitting there eating a Sub Stop sandwich with him, like, you know, sitting on the playground, looking up at the RCA building going, wow.
Yeah.
How did this happen?
It's like they forget about you. It's like,
I mean, I can't even get in the building now.
Yeah. Same with us. Yeah.
After, you know, several million album sales, I can't even get in the damn building.
It's crazy. You know? Yeah. Yeah.
But all in all, I mean, I do agree with what Bill Simmons, our the last manager we had with Fitzgerald and Hartley. Bill said, you know, if you guys were not on RCA Records, I don't think you would have sold nearly as many records as you did.
Probably so.
RCA was a record selling machine.
Yeah.
And I agree with that assessment. I don't think we would have sold as many records as we did had we not been on RCA. So, I mean, I'm eternally grateful for RCA. They gave me a career. And, you know, we sold a fair amount of records. Had a lot of success at radio, and we had a great career.
Yeah. You told me, you wrote Big Iron Horses. You wrote that song, right?
I did.
And you told me a story about Don Henley, about that song.
Well, it was about that song, and When She Cries, actually.
Okay.
We got word from one of the sales guys at RCA that Don Henley's representative had called the label and wanted a copy of the CD. Well, you know, they just could have gone down to Tower Records to get a copy of it,
Yeah.
but they didn't want to pay for it. So,
Sure.
you know, you know, the guy said it was just a little cloak and dagger, you know, and he was like, he kept pushing the guy. He said, who is this? Why do you want a copy of this? Who is this for? Who, you know? And he said he finally wore the guy down, and the guy said that he was calling to get Don Henley a copy. Well, of course, you know, we didn't have any idea why Don Henley wanted a copy of our CD, so we were kind of like, wow,
Yeah, wow, yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Then we found out he was considering suing us.
Really?
He felt that Big Iron Horses was too similar to take it to the limit.
Yeah.
Which they're two completely, completely different songs. And he felt that When She Cries copied The Last Worthless Evening. And, you know, if you sit down and think about it, it's the opening melody of When She Cries. The road I have traveled on. I know you broke up with him. That's what Henley heard. And Henley heard Big Iron Horses. It's in a minor key.
It's the walk up on.
There are walk-ups, which are common.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. They're in every song. Yeah.
Common to songs in 6/8 in minor keys that every song has, and that's what he heard.
I think it was also your style too was similar to the Eagles. That, you know, the vocal, the oohs, and all the background vocal stuff that y'all put in there. And
here's the thing. I think that Don Henley is a brilliant songwriter, and I think he's a brilliant singer. I think that he's one of the best singer songwriters of the 20th century.
Yeah.
But you know, he and the Eagles did not have a monopoly on vocal harmony.
No.
Or oohs and ahs.
Right.
Or anything else.
That's true.
And apparently Don thought that he did.
Yeah.
And of course the lawsuit never went anywhere because I have a feeling that his attorneys told him, Don, you're gonna lose this. Don't even bother. You don't have a chance of winning this. They're not even close.
Bad publicity and everything, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you don't want, you know, you're gonna be suing the little guy and you're gonna lose.
And they were kind of making a comeback too around that time, you know.
Was that around Hell Freezes Over?
It was like the early 90s that they started.
It was like Hell Freezes Over.
Yeah.
Now.
Uh-huh.
I don't know. I guess he got diverted.
I guess he got a little threatened there.
Well, you know, I don't know. But at any rate, you know, I ran into him at the Ivy in Beverly Hills. And the Ivy is a small restaurant. Very quaint, very, very quaint little restaurant in Beverly Hills. And our label guy from Rising Tide, when we were in the Buffalo Club, took us there. And Don Henley came in with his wife and an older couple, which I'm thinking might have been her parents,
mm-hmm.
And sat at the very next table. And this place is not big.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think that he knew who I was. I don't think that he recognized me or anything, but I had a very uncomfortable face to face with him in the hallway from the restrooms, which two people passing had to turn and put their backs up against the wall to get by each other.
Yeah.
And I run nose to nose into Don Henley in the hallway from the restroom. And we looked at each other briefly and very quickly looked away and, you know, made it so each other could pass. And I'm like, good God. Oh,
never,
well.
Never said anything, huh?
Oh, no, not a word. No, yeah.
Every band has, or every touring artist or band always has road stories. Funny stories that happen on the road. You told me a story. I think you were at the Grammys. Is that what it was when Michael Jackson performed?
Oh, yeah.
He came and sit down by. Yeah.
Well, we were on the Grammys.
You performed. That's what it was. Yeah.
Yeah, we performed, and Michael was sitting in the front row with Quincy Jones and Stevie Wonder.
Yeah.
Front row center. Now, what the audience doesn't see at home is whenever there's a commercial break, the place, it turns into chaos. People changing
Everybody
seats.
Getting up, going to the bathroom. And
Seat sitters getting up to let the artist back into their seats. And people, the only way to cross is right in front of the stage, in between the stage and the front row.
Yeah.
And there's only room for single file people to get by between the stage and the front row.
Yeah.
So we had to cross in front of Michael, Stevie, and Quincy. And we're trying to get through. And Paul Gregg, he gets in front of Michael Jackson and he turns his head and he stares at him and he becomes catatonic. Couldn't say anything, couldn't move. He was just in a complete, just awestruck.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm standing in front of Michael Jackson and I don't know what to do, you know. And Michael got nervous. And you know, he reached his hand out to Paul and he said, you know, we had just performed. He said, hey, man, he said, cool song. And Paul just stood there, didn't take his hand, didn't nothing. And so I'm pushing Paul.
Ooh, Paul, go. Yeah.
You got to move. And I looked down at Michael. I looked down at Michael and I went, sorry, man. And, you know, Michael went, that's okay, man. That's okay. You know, it's like, okay. You
know? That's pretty cool.
Oh, you idiot.
He was starstruck.
What are you doing? You know.
That's cool, man. That's really cool.
I mean,
story.
I was as starstruck as he
well,
was.
Well, sure, but, yeah.
You know, yeah. I mean, come on. You know, well, seriously. Sure.
But you try to be cool, you know, you don't want to act too starstruck, but.
Yeah. But, well.
So you guys, when did y'all actually decide to hang it up?
Well, Larry, I think hang it up for good.
Hang it up for good. Yeah. No, not come back the second time, but the first time.
Oh, the first
I know y'all.
Time.
Yeah,
the first time, like I mentioned earlier, Larry, we had just gotten back from Europe playing with Toto. Larry called a meeting the day after we got home and informed us that he was leaving the band. And, you know, that was the first time.
But then you guys continued on after that.
We continued on.
Made several albums after that.
We made Big Iron Horses and we made Matters of the Heart.
Yeah.
RCA gave us Matters of the Heart because they felt they owed it to us.
Yeah.
And the songs, there were a few good songs on it, but they didn't put out the right singles, in my opinion.
Yeah.
They wanted to be done with us. Matters of the Heart was going to be it, and they didn't put any effort into it. They released it was either one or two singles off of that. And I had a radio guy come up to me several years later and tell me that Well, no, actually, it wasn't several years later. It was during the time the second single was out. And he said, John, he said, I want you to know, he said, this has never happened in my memory. He said, but the label called me and told me, pull the Restless Heart record. We need the spot on your playlist for somebody else. And, you know, he said, I've never had a label call me and tell me to pull one of their artists, one of their established artists off my playlist.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was going on. They were done with us.
Yeah.
So, we got back together briefly in 1998. We put out a greatest hits record with two new singles on it, and the records didn't do well at radio. And so that was the end of that.
Yeah.
Though we did tour with Vince Gill that year. All year. Then in 2001, our booking agent, Rick Shipp, who was the head of William Morris agency in Nashville, called Larry and said, look, he said, I think we can resurrect this thing. He said, things have changed in country. And he said, I think we can go back on the road and make some money. And so we called a meeting, and Rick Shipp had to see it with his own eyes that all five of us were in the same room over at Greg Jennings' house. And he said, boys, he said, I think we can do this. He said, I think we can go back on the road and make some money.
Yeah.
And so the last half of 2001, we kicked it off again, and we were together until 2 years ago when, once again, Larry quit the band. And, the first time he quit, we had a chance because we still had a record deal.
Sure.
This time we had no record deal. There was no chance of us trying to go on without him, in my opinion.
Yeah.
A couple of the other guys thought they could. I didn't. I knew what was going to happen, and I wasn't willing to, as Greg Jennings said, I wasn't willing to try to push that boulder up the hill again.
Right.
And so as soon as I got that word, I remember sitting at home when I got the text, the group text from Larry, and my wife was standing at the kitchen counter. And I turned around from my desk and I said, well, I'm retired. Larry just quit. And her jaw dropped. And it wasn't a look of, oh my gosh, you know, that's terrible. Larry quit. It was a look of, you're going to be home 24/7, 365 now, aren't you?
Oh boy.
You know, that look, you know,
yeah. Like,
what am I going to do?
You know? Yeah.
I don't want you home 24/7.
Wow.
So, that's when that happened. That was a little over 2 years ago. It happened in January, of 2021, January 2021. Yeah. So, yeah, so a little over 2 years ago. And I pretty much was doing the same thing I was doing all through COVID. You know, yeah. I mean, COVID just about killed us. We only did 16 dates in 2020.
Yeah.
We didn't do much more than that in 2019. You know, I was pretty much sitting around the house.
Yeah.
So I just considered, well, I'm just going to be sitting around the house like I've been doing.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
I had hip replacement surgery. And then all of a sudden my wife decided, well, she didn't decide, but she kept bringing up the fact that she would love to move back to Arizona because her boys are here, grandkids are here. And I resisted the idea. And then all of a sudden I started thinking about it, and I started thinking, well, why not? I mean, I've got nothing to keep me here. I mean, I do have my daughter, my grandkids there. But I couldn't take the cold and damp anymore.
Yeah.
Laura couldn't take the humidity anymore. And so I wasn't even sure we were going to be able to do it.
Yeah.
And then luckily, you know, real estate being what it is, you know, I got enough money for my home in Nashville to be able to buy in Sun City, Arizona.
That's cool.
I wish I'd done it 2.5 years ago when I first retired.
Yeah.
I love it here.
I'd have never got to meet you if that had happened.
Well, that's true. But
I'm sure that wouldn't have kept you here, but
I love it here. Wish I'd done it sooner.
I love Arizona too. Yeah.
Yeah.
You're in a good spot. So between Restless Heart and you retiring, you were with another band called Buffalo Club. How did that come about?
Well, I mentioned earlier that I was sitting across the street from RCA with B. Bertels.
Right.
And Beeb and I, and I didn't realize what a big deal this was for Beeb to get back into that part of the music business and be in a band again. Bill Cuomo, who's a keyboard player who was very big in L.A., back in the 70s and 80s, had moved to Nashville. And I remember having lunch with Beeb and Bill, and Bill had played on our album, Big Iron Horses, played on a couple of tracks. And, I remember Bill looking over at Beeb at lunch going, well, Beeb, this is quite a big deal for you to even think about getting in another band. And Beeb said, well, yeah, I know, you know. And I'm like, oh, I didn't have any idea, you know. But eventually Beeb didn't work out. And we had Ron Hemby. And we,
what
we
a singer,
needed,
man.
Wow. We needed a third to be a trio. And we got a guy named Charlie Kelly, who's pretty well known around town, around Nashville, guitar player, songwriter, and Nan Kelly's husband, by the way, from CMT.
Hmm.
She has a couple of shows that she does. And I went to Barry Beckett, Barry was very interested, thankfully, very interested in producing it.
Yeah.
He produced a great album on us.
Oh yeah.
Unfortunately, there were inner conflicts, and there were conflicts with the record label and the management. There were just conflicts everywhere. On my end, I just seemed to be conflicted with all of it, and conflicted with Charlie. And we had different ideas about the way we wanted this thing to work. And I just went, I can't do this anymore. You know, and I left after we had a hit single.
Yeah.
Actually, it was the highest charting debut record at Radio and Records from the previous 2 years. And I think it went, top 10. I'm not sure.
Was that Nothing Less Than Love?
Nothing Less Than Love.
I
think it went top 10. I don't remember.
Yeah.
I think it went to number 7, if I recall correctly. And they tried being a duo and releasing a couple singles after that, and it didn't work out.
Yeah.
Finally, Ron came over to the house one day, and he told me that he had had a meeting with Charlie, and he had just decided to pack it in. Mm. And so that was the end of that. But Barry produced a great album, great songs. And I think that we would have been, I think we would have been big. I mean, that's what radio was telling us. Radio was telling us that they thought we were going to be really big, and they really wanted to play our records. And it was a shame that it just goes to show you how hard it is to keep a group of people together. That if you break through as a band and have any success, it's truly a miracle.
It really
because
is.
I think it was Glenn Frey that said, you know, you just get to the point where you can't stand the sound of the other guy's hair growing. You know, it gets that bad
Oh,
at
yeah.
times.
Did y'all ever have, with Restless Heart, did y'all ever have any knockdown drag out, like you want to kill somebody or fight or something like that? That ever happened between you guys, or
No,
y'all pretty much?
it got into some yelling matches, you know, but that's to be expected, you know. Nerves get raw, and you know, people have different ideas, and you're out on the road and you're tired and you're worn out, and you know, you're trapped on a bus. That's normal, but no, never knocked down, never close to any knockdown drag outs. Of
That's
course,
good.
that may depend on who you talk to.
Yeah, they may
You
have
know,
other stories, huh?
I never came close to having a knockdown drag out with anybody. You
Yeah.
know.
That's cool. Who did y'all listen to on the bus?
You know, I remember in when we first got big, I think it was during the Wheels album. There was a period there where we put on Buck Owens live at Carnegie Hall
Oh, man.
almost every night before every show.
Really?
This probably went on for about a month, you know. I remember being able to tell Buck that story. We were at an, I think, the ACM award show or something, and we were going to present an award with Buck, and we're waiting backstage to go on to do the presentation, and I told him that story, and he seemed shocked
Really?
that what? Restless Heart was listening to me? I was like, yeah. Yeah. You're a legend, Buck.
He
You
was he
know?
yeah, he was a big influence on my life, because when I was a little kid, my dad was a
Yeah.
big Buck Owens fan, and every Christmas he would play that Christmas album that Buck
Yeah.
Owens put out.
Yeah.
And so I remember listening to that, and I used to have a little snare drum, and I'd play the
Yeah.
drums with their drummer, you know, and
Yeah.
I that's what I grew on, man. Grew up on.
Yeah. Buck was a nice guy too. He was a very, very nice
I
guy.
never got to
We,
meet him. I wish I would have.
you know, we were doing a presentation, maybe a year later on the ACMs, and Buck was in the front row. And I had these custom boots made, and I had this black short jacket trimmed in rhinestones,
Yeah.
and you know, custom.
Did you get that at
Custom.
Manuel?
No, I got it at a place. I got them at a place called Dangerous Threads. Do you remember that store?
I do. I do remember that place. Yeah.
Dangerous Threads was my store of choice. It was
Okay.
a pretty much rock and roll, but they did country, you know, but not certainly not like Manuel, or Nudie. But I went to Dangerous Threads for my stuff, and so I'm. You know, we're doing this presentation, and I look down the front row off to the left, and I see Buck is sitting there in the front row, and he's waving his arms up at the stage. And so I'm on camera, so I kind of slowly tilt my head, both, well, I, you know, what's he telling me? There's a fire, what's going on? You know, I can't figure out why he's doing this. And when the camera was off me, I looked at Buck, and I made a gesture like me? Are you like me? And he made a gesture like, yes, you. And he pointed down, and I looked down. Well, the stage isn't on fire. I don't have any idea. So we get through presenting, and I saw him a little bit later, and I said, you know. Or Buck actually sought me out is what happened. He sought me out, and he came over to me, and he said, "I was trying to get your attention." I said, "Well, I saw that." And I said, "What were you doing?" He said, I was trying to find out if you wanted to sell those boots.
Why oh, you're on camera?
I had these custom pair of boots. They were aqua color with the silver toes.
Yeah, the tips. And
silver tips on the hood.
Yeah, I had those too.
Buck just fell in love with those boots.
Man.
And he said, "Name your price. I got to have them."
Wow.
And I just said, "Buck, I just bought them. I just really, literally just bought them." And he said, "If you ever decide to sell them, call me, name your price." And I'm like, "Well, okay, you know." And I never did get a chance to sell him those boots.
Yeah,
you know, because he passed away.
It's pretty cool. Who would you say, out of all your travels and meeting people, who would you say was the biggest person that you think you've ever met before?
Well, besides the United States president, sitting president,
which one
Bush,
was that? George W. Bush?
George Bush 41.
41, okay.
George H.W. Bush.
Yeah, okay.
He invited us, he wanted us to sing for him at the Peavey Factory in Meridian, Mississippi. He was doing a speech there.
Okay.
And he was very personable. He was a fan.
He loved country music. Yeah.
Yeah. And he was a fan of the band. He specifically requested us and we came down and he actually spent about 20 minutes with us. Told us a great story about Vince Gill.
Oh, really?
He said, "You fellas know Vince Gill." "Yes, sir, Mr. President, we do. He's a very good friend." He said, "Well, you know," he said, "I had Vince at the White House." And he said, "I had him down on the putting green." And he said, I asked him, I said, "Well, say, Vince," I said, "you know, what do you shoot? What do you shoot?" And he said to me, "Well, Mr. President, I'm a scratch golfer." And President Bush said, "Oh." And he said, he just went on with putting. And he said, "Well," he said, "I was going to ask him if he wanted to play golf with me," he said, "but I didn't get to be president by being stupid." So, I wasn't gonna play golf with that guy.
That's cool.
Yeah.
So that was the one, huh? President
Well,
Bush.
He was President Bush, and I think probably the other one was Jack Nicholson.
Wow. Yeah.
We were at the Don Henley concert in LA. And at the old Universal Amphitheater, and before they tore it down, and the green room was outdoors in the back. It was a very large area, and of course, Don Henley show. There was a slew of celebrities there. Jeff and Mike Porcaro were there, and I spoke with them. Stan Lynch and Mike Campbell were there because Stan and Mike both wrote songs for Henley's album. Mm-hmm. And I saw Jack Nicholson over the, running around back there, dressed totally in black, wearing black sunglasses. And our agent went over and had a conversation with him. And I was too chicken to go over and say anything to
him.
So Larry Fitzgerald and I, Larry was my ride back to the hotel. So we decided to leave. The VIP parking lot was out in the back beyond that. And the way you got there was a narrow covered walkway that led to one single wooden door that you opened up to walk out to the parking lot. So we get to the door and I'm just about to put my hand on the handle and the door flies open and there I stand face to face with Jack Nicholson.
Wow.
And we're both standing there. And so I back away and I motion and I say, "After you, sir." And Jack walks through the door and he stops in front of me and he turns his head to the side to look at me, flips up his sunglasses and goes, "Shabop, shabop," and drops his sunglasses and walks on. Said, so I get out in the parking lot with Larry Fitzgerald And I start jumping up and down and I say, that's the coolest thing that's ever happened to me. You know?
That is pretty cool.
Yeah.
Wow, man. Yeah. You got some great stories, man. We could sit here all night and just listen to stories. Maybe we'll have to do this again and get some more stuff.
I got stories. I have to engage with somebody like you before they come to mind.
I know. And you're a great storyteller too, man. You got a gift.
Oh, thank you.
You do. But I appreciate you being on my show, man. And I know the people out there are going to love this. And I want to do it again sometime. And I want to see you in person again sometime.
Well, you never know. Let me get this new knee. That's the next thing. I had the hip replacement. Now I got to have the knee replacement.
Yeah. I'll just get a little teaser out there for the audience. We did a track for a song that we're going to get John to sing the lead vocal on. Somehow or another, we're going to have to get it done.
Well, we're going to have to get Chris Goff back to Phoenix here.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he's going to have to line up a studio or something so we can get this done.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then after it's all said and done, we're going to fly out there and I'm going to bring my son and we're going to make a video of it.
Cool.
We're going to make a music video.
All right.
You want to do that?
We can do it in the walking pool here at Sun City.
Let's do it, man.
Walking in the pool.
There's beautiful scenery out there, man. It'd be awesome.
There is. I thought I would miss the green, and maybe I haven't been here long enough to miss the green.
Yeah.
I don't know, but I do have green grass where I am. But I love it here. I really do.
Well, I'm glad for you. And like I said, we miss you here, but understand.
Well, I miss you guys, and you never know. You never know when I might show up back there.
If you ever come back up here, make sure we know. We'll meet for lunch.
We'll do. Absolutely. That's going to be one of my first stops is lunch club.
Sounds great. Love you, John. Appreciate you very much, and I appreciate the friendship. I really, really do.
Love you too, Bobby, and I'm so glad we got a chance to do this. And hello, everybody, and I hope you all enjoy the blog here.
All right, man. God bless you. We'll talk to you later.
Thanks, man. Okay, thank
bye-bye.
You. Bye-bye.